January 30th, 1905, at 1 o'clock in the morning in the midst of a driving rain, Oscar Ritter boarded a northbound train in St. Joseph, Missouri. Rain turned to snow, and he arrived at the end of the line in Bonesteel, South Dakota, the following afternoon in a raging blizzard. Continuing by bobsled as far as Burke, he was forced to stop by the severe cold and found lodging in a sod house for several days to wait out the weather. Finally, on February 8th, he made his way to a rolling quarter-mile square of prairie, 3.5 miles northeast of the new frontier town of Gregory. That land has been our family's home in one way or another ever since. Joseph Ritter was born in February of 1822 in Baden, a region along the Rhine River in what is today southwestern Germany. At the age of 26, Joseph fled the upheaval and chaos of the 1848 German Revolution and came to the United States, part of the first major wave of European immigration to America that would dominate the country for the rest of that century. Within the decade, Joseph had married Mary Wehrle, another Baden emigre 10 years his junior, and they made their way west to settle and begin farming near what was then the frontier town of St. Joseph, Missouri. Mary bore them 13 children, 7 of whom survived to adulthood. Oscar, the fourth of these, was born on January 7, 1868 in St. Joseph. Raised working on their farm, he attended a rural school sporadically as a youth, but eventually completed 4 years at the Chillicothe Normal School while in his 20s, receiving degrees in teaching and business. He taught at rural schools in Missouri for several years before opening a small general store together with his younger brother, Herman. On October 12, 1902, in the Hope Church near St. Joe, Oscar married 26-year-old Rosa Mary Kuntz, shown here together many years later. Though the Kuntz farm prospers today, a century ago, Rosa had endured a difficult childhood marked by privation and poverty. The second youngest of 6 children born to Swiss immigrants, Christian and Mary Kuntz, Rosa lost her father not long after the birth of her youngest sibling. She was sent to live with a neighboring family. As a consequence, she began working early in life and was able to complete only a few short terms at the nearby rural school. On February 13, 1904, a year and a half after their marriage, Oscar and Rosa's first son, Emmett, was born in their small house in St. Joe. Around that same time, Oscar began dreaming of a new life for his young family, one that lay far beyond the confines of his Missouri general store. The Homestead Act, passed by Congress in 1862, granted 160 acres of land to any person at least 21 years of age, capable of proving up on the given land. Process that included living there for 5 years, farming successfully, and paying the $18 fee. Beginning in the 1880s, as Native American peoples in the Upper Plains were confined to reservations, the U.S. began opening large portions of their lands for resettlement. In the summer of 1904, 2,400 applicants, including Oscar Ritter, arrived in Yankton, South Dakota for a lottery, dividing up newly opened land on what had been part of the Lakota's Rosebud Reservation. On August 8th, the fourth day of that drawing, Oscar drew number 394. Rosa was devastated. She wrote later, "When this news came, I just sat down and cried, as I did not want to go to this newly opened country of blizzards, coyotes, and rattlesnakes to make a new home." Though Oscar had scouted out prime locations, by the time his turn for land selection came up late on the 11th of that month, most of his choices were taken. He took a guess, and the lot he received became our farm. The following winter, in January of 1905, Oscar left St. Joseph to prove up on the homestead, returning for good in March with Rosa and Emmett in tow. Their first home was a small 8-foot by 12-foot tar paper shack, expanded that summer to encompass 2 rooms that were insulated with prairie sod more than 2 feet thick. The nearby Oscar Michaud homestead, restored today, gives us some idea of what the Ritters' early house looked like on the inside. A dirt floor, crates used as simple tables, a small bed. They lived in this sod house for more than a decade. Rosa gave birth to her 2 other children within its walls. Alfred, born on March 4th, 1906, and Lester on September 8th, 1910. If a family of five wasn't enough to fill that space, during the first years, Rosa's mother, Mary Kuntz, also came to live with them on the farm. Grandpa also remembers his Uncle Fritz, a Civil War veteran who deserted from the Confederate Army, coming to help out. Oscar and Rosa planted the first crop in 1905, eventually growing corn, wheat, oats, hay, and barley, later adding livestock, including cattle, hogs, sheep, and chickens. All farming, of course, for the first two decades was done with draft animals. Grandpa recalls.
He even had mules.
Were they better pulling than the horses?
Yeah, they were tougher.
So why didn't he have all mules?
Oh, I don't know. They were harder to take care of.
And they kick?
Yeah.
Did they stay in the big barn too?
Yeah. That's what kicked those sides off.
Really? So how many did you have at one time? How many did you have at one time?
I think we had four at one time.
Well, is that the most you ever had? Of horses and mules together?
No. Horses and mules probably have a dozen or more.
Oh, okay. But you only use six to a team or four to a team or?
Well, it depends what you want to pull. We use six on a two-bottom plow.
Now they don't
pull. Four in the back and two in the lead. The ones in the lead, they didn't never pull them on sitters. That's the back one's fault.
Family lore has it that Oscar was also an avid gardener, a habit he would maintain even in retirement. In addition to his flower, berry, and vegetable gardens on the farm, he planted a 5-acre apple orchard just east of the house and dug the cave to store all of this produce. The difficulties of farming a quarter of land with a horse-drawn plow and raising enough to feed a family seem hard enough, but there were additional challenges in the beginning. A well had to be dug that first year to supply water, and outbuildings had to be constructed to store harvested grain and shelter animals, a chore made more difficult by the fact that timber for buildings had to be brought by wagon from Bonesteel, nearly 30 miles away. Oscar and his brother-in-law, Charlie Schneider, built the first building, the Big Barn, in 1908, where thereafter they stored hay and kept the draft animals. The entire family worked hard, planting, tilling, harvesting, tending to animals, and more.
Grandpa, did you guys have dairy cows when you were growing up? Did you have to milk? Did you have to milk when you were a kid?
Yeah.
Yeah?
Yeah, one or two.
A whole herd of them.
That's really exciting.
Hard work and perseverance paid off. In 1916, the modern wood frame house was built. Grandpa recalls all three brothers sleeping in one upstairs room so that the others could be used for storage. A chicken coop was added in 1917. 1 year later, the Ritters bought their first car, a Model T, for $1,000. A decade later, in 1928, they upgraded to a Model A, bought their first tractor, a steel-wheeled and lugged International. Emmett left the farm upon graduating from high school and eventually settled back in Rolla, Missouri, where he owned and ran a dental lab that made prosthetic teeth. Lester left in 1934 to begin work with the Army Corps of Engineers, eventually settling in Omaha, Nebraska, helping to oversee the construction of a number of the major dams along the Missouri River, as well as many missile bases throughout the Midwest. Alfred stayed on in Gregory to help his parents' farm, though he'll occasionally mention a few journeys he took in his wild younger days, including a trip to the Chicago World's Fair, where he remembers drinking a lot of beer, and a summer working in the Black Hills for the CCC in the 1930s. Those years, the 30s, were hard ones throughout the country.
We had dust storms and the dirt come up over the fences, just like snowbanks. And it was terrible. A lot of South Dakota soil came down.
I think it got something in Colorado.
That's where a good soil went. What about in the houses with this dust up? Was it just dirt in the houses, just constantly?
Oh, yeah. We, of course, didn't have any fancy things, but my mother put damp towels on the windowsill to try and keep some of it out, and still got an awful lot in. And then, of course, the grasshoppers come, and they said, and I know we had terrible grasshoppers. They just come in swarms, and they eat everything.
And they wouldn't come every year, in just periods of time, wasn't it?
At that time, they just come in a swarm and eat everything there was left to eat after the dust storms. Mm-hmm. Yes, I would
eat the clothes off the line. Clothesline.
Yeah.
Lay the curtains in the house. But it got so dark that the chickens would go to roost. It would just be completely dark, like night. And we had
terrible dust storms.
That was terrible.
Yeah, I remember too. A lot of farmers lost their farms because of it. But we hung on to ours. Worked hard to pay the taxes and everything else, but we did have our farm when it was all over.
In school, I learned a man who died by the gun, but not of those who died by the hole. The land has drunk the rains of many a farmer's blood, not forgotten and buried long ago. And where are the hands that plowed fields without sleep, hands that saved a dying calf without rest? And where's the feet that walk down hot dusty trails on their way to seek their fortune gone west? And where are the fathers who died in the dust, and mothers who died hungry in the snow? And where's the kids that watch the banks plow the houses down? Those are things I guess my teachers never know.
Like other local families that managed to hold on to their farms, Oscar and Rosa were able to secure feed and seed loans to get them and their farm through the dirty 30s, just in time to pass it on to the next generation. Growing up just a few miles away from the Ritter Farm, Clara Janetta Spicknell, on the lower right, was born on July 4th, 1912, the fourth of eight children of Charles and Matilda Spicknell. Charles and Matilda were themselves founding members of the local community. Matilda Hull, daughter of Norwegian immigrants in Minnesota, homesteaded in Gregory as a young single woman, met her husband Charles not long after in nearby Bonesteel, he being a quiet and thoughtful man who had taught on the Ute Reservation out west before coming to South Dakota. Together, with few resources, they created a large, happy, and tight-knit family.
We lived out to the farm. We had no indoor plumbing. We lived back in the primitive times. But there was eight of us, and we got along very well together. And I think we had a wonderful mom and dad. Mom made terrific bread. She had made eight loaves of bread at one time. We'd come home from school and cut off all the crusts. And she put up with it. And she had a reputation for making her baked beans, Now, Mom was a wonderful cook, but we were very, very poor. Everything that we got came hard. But Mom and Dom did a wonderful job raising us, I think. We all came back with pretty good morals and everything. But we had a big garden, and that kept us. We did a lot of canning, and we had one cow, so we got our milk. And so we had a pretty good life with Mom. They would take wheat from the farm and take it to the mill and have it ground. So we had our own flour, and we had lots of apples. We'd buy apples by the barrel. But we had a wonderful life. Us kids, we lived in a neighborhood that was surrounded by kids. And there was eight of us, so with all the neighborhood kids, we had quite a time. They always collected around our place, and we played what these kids don't know of anymore. It's kick the can, steal sticks. But we played croquet. Mom and Dad were, they didn't really play, but they were always knew where we were. They kept us at home. So we didn't wander around very far. But we did have a good life. And I think Mom and Dad did. They sacrificed so much. And now I'm just beginning to appreciate what they did do for us. But we had a good life.
Hard work was countered by a well-earned social life. As elsewhere throughout the Midwest, traveling dance bands such as that led by Lawrence Welk played area halls, and more down-home fun took place at local barn dances.
Going to the dances, I can remember, Noah always would take me with him and bring me home. But we always had a good time for dancing. Square dancing especially was very popular there at one time. We'd go to the different farm homes and they'd clean the hay and straw to the top of the barns, and we danced in the dances.
Who played the music at those barn dances?
They had a fiddler and an accordion player, and just residents, the people that lived there would come with their instruments and play. Fiddle and accordion and banjo.
They were just neighbors.
Yeah, just neighbors.
Bohemian music.
Yeah.
A lot of Bohemian music. Right. Mm-hmm.
So how did you dress when you went to the dances?
Whatever we had on.
it wasn't a special night out dressing up. But
nothing special.
The square dancers had their long skirts, full skirts.
About her childhood, my favorite story that Grandma tells involves her church's Methodist Youth Fellowship. In the late 1920s, their principal activities included roller skating in the local theater, holding dances that she swears she never went to, putting on ice cream socials, but not, she tells me, eating the Catterses' ice cream because their cows grazed in an onion patch. And most importantly, they went on hay rides. One particular hay ride when she was in high school took place at the Ritter Farm, and she remembers thinking that the young man driving the horses that evening was rather cute. Some years after that fateful ride, Alfred married Janetta on June 3, 1937, at 6 o'clock in the morning, in order to give them time to get started driving west for their honeymoon. They made it as far as the Black Hills that night, and eventually toured Yellowstone Park in western Wyoming. When they returned from their honeymoon, Alfred and Janetta settled at first on the farm, living and working with his parents, and later relocated to town where Alfred worked as a mailman for 6 years. Not wasting any time, their first child was born 10 months after their honeymoon, Janice Lorene, on April 22, 1938, followed in June of 1939 by a little sister, Elaine, and another, Marty, in March of 1944. Same year, after nearly 4 decades of farming, Oscar and Rosa retired to town, left Alfred and his young family the farm. They were blessed with a long retirement, filled with gardening and church activities, and lived well into their 90s. Oscar died in 1962, followed a few years later by Rosa in 1966. Oscar, incidentally, had never learned to drive a tractor, using draft horses to the very end. Under Alfred and Janetta's stewardship, with their hard work ethic and growing family, the farm entered a sort of golden age in terms of its productivity and certainly in terms of its social life. Electricity finally arrived in 1948, replacing the 12-volt wind generator system in use at the farm since the 19-teens. One final addition to the family came just prior to that, when, as Marty tells it, the long-awaited boy arrived. Larry Alfred Ritter was born on June 24, 1947, and came home from Burke to find a house full of girls eager to tease and spoil him. He soon joined them in doing chores, joining 4-H, going to the one-room schoolhouse a mile north, attending church, and most of all, carousing with their Johnson cousins.
Thank you. going out to the Ritter Farm, I mean, I remember feeding how many lambs, I don't know. That was always one of the really fun things to do was when they had the lambs.
And we would come to Gregory every summer. And so I enjoyed going out with the Ritters on their farm and gathered eggs and helped slop the hogs and go out in the pasture and bring the cows back so I could milk them and everything. And we were sheep shearing and
Marty would take me to collect eggs from the chickens, and I was just scared to death of them. And milking the cow, I was like, you're going to touch what? You were all very patient with the city girls. So.
Well, going to the Ritter Farm was really, really special. We haven't mentioned the dress-up. I think we all did. Dress up was really great because we had Janice and Elaine's prom dresses and their bras. Oh, it was fun. I loved them. We spent hours doing that. Well, we would ride the horses out there, and I know Port Alfred and Janetta, that I can remember tying them up in the stalls. And, well, we never had stalls, we never had a barn for them, so I had just a rope around their neck and to hold them in the stall. Mm-hmm. One panicked and pulled back and was strangling.
Sunshine.
No, I think it was Shadow. It doesn't matter. She would have died. I was running, I found a big knife. I was going through Alfred's tools and cut her loose. But then we loved playing in the haystacks. I'm sure we messed up lots of haystacks. Yeah. I would get such terrible asthma. I could hardly breathe. But I'd go right back and do it again. We would jump from the barn onto the haystacks, or just climb them. And that was just really, really fun. Just that's what I remember. Just fun, fun, fun. And I also liked going to the country school. Sometimes they were the programs. And they were really like Christmas programs. And I remember it being cold, but. Yeah, we get to watch the programs, but sometimes I would just get to go along into recess, and that was just really exciting.
I remember Dixie went one time, too, and it was snowing. We had to hang on to the fence line as we walked this miles. Well, Dixie was just couldn't believe it. That's what we did when I was going to grade school out there at One Room Schoolhouse. Our recesses were spent drowning at gophers, and I don't remember stuffing them. We would skin them and sell the skins.
Skunks.
You did. We'd sell the pelts, I think, for 5 cents a piece or something like that.
We used them for rugs in a dollhouse.
But we'd rub them with salt and we'd cure them the proper way.
Well, I remember the taco parties. It was Sarah and I, those tacos, and would either be at the farm or at Green's house or Gladine's house, and the folks would all be eating their tacos, and we'd be, when we got a little bit older, we went downtown and chased the boys, I guess. And I remember having circuses out there. And doing animals.
Where was that?
At the farm.
Stilts.
Rick was juggling. Yeah. And Dad was riding a bicycle doing tricks on the bicycle. Yeah. And Dad was selling
oranges. Was doing tricks on a bicycle?
Yes, he was.
The Sundays to the Missouri River, when we'd go with George across the river in this. Nobody'd believe it today. I mean, we saw movies up last night in this old
and not
boat.
A single life jacket.
Yeah, not a life jacket. Wow. And we'd take turns taking us all across over to the sandbar, and he had these old stinky nets set out in the river with
stinky cheese.
Stinky cheese in them, catching the fish. That was a big Sunday time for us. And going to the dam. Everybody learned to swim out there, but one person, that's me.
I'm still alive, I don't know. Because I still don't know how to swim.
I never learned to swim out there.
I remember
consider the horses being out at our farm. I didn't get a horse. It had to wait till Larry came along.
But it was all in play. She wasn't really a horse.
But when I was growing up, I had to rely on, we just rode the Johnson's horses, but they had them out there and had a good time. What, a little colt was born out there, wasn't it?
Yeah.
And
I really didn't have a horse. Blaze couldn't be qualified.
Yes, she was.
She was a crazy wild horse that didn't like to be ridden. But some of the good memories were up at the Missouri cabin after it was flooded, and we used to round up all the cattle up there. The ranchers up there probably are still cussing us because we would see how big of a herd we could get rounded up. And I think back now. This was in the summertime, so they had little calves, and we were just chasing those cows for miles and miles. We never did find their mothers again. But you always had the good horses with Sunshine and Shadow. And
that would kick you and bite you and
butt
you.
They were wonderful compared to Blaze.
We used to go down the hill and anything that had wheels on it. We would get old carts and old bikes and whatever.
Or sleigh rides down the hill.
Yeah, sleigh rides down the hill.
Back when I was in probably late grade school, we took some of the old farm equipment that was up on the hill, and we made our own four-wheel drive cart that we drove like a chariot. Down the hill. We had two front wheels that pivoted, and we had the ropes that we guided on, and we had the platform in the back, and we used to push like heck to get that thing up the hill and then have a 30-second thrill ride down.
We weren't that little when we did that. We were bigger.
No,
we were pretty big.
It was a
pretty exciting ride.
I don't know. We were probably 12 or 14, and Larry he was driving the Jeep. We were probably off fishing someplace, maybe, coming back, and he's like, okay, I want to see how fast I can go. I've never gone over 50, he says. He says, and so we're on this little dirt road out past his house, and he says, okay, now you watch the speedometer, I'm going to drive. That's how we're kicking along that road. And I says, faster, faster, you're going to make it. Oh, we went 50 miles an hour in that Jeep, but it seemed like 100, let me tell you.
In the midst of all the fun, the Ritter siblings were growing up. In August of 1956, just 2 months after graduating, Janice married her high school sweetheart, Leroy Dummer, and they settled down at first on a nearby farm. 9 months later, Janice gave birth to a son, Dick, and 9 months after that, added a daughter, Deb, thus giving Alfred and Janetta the first of their many grandchildren to come. Janice and Leroy added a daughter, Carmel, in 1961 when living in Springfield, South Dakota, while Leroy went to college, and a final son, Rod, a year later in Wyoming. The Dummers finally settled in Newcastle, Wyoming, where Janice worked at the local high school office, and Leroy taught and later served as the high school principal in nearby Osage. Elaine graduated from Gregory High in 1957, and after a summer in Los Angeles with her aunt Eva, attended nursing school in Omaha, Nebraska, where she graduated in 1960. A few months later, she married, in her own words, a Scotch-Irish teenager named Robert Johnston, and soon settled back in Omaha. Also wasting no time, she gave birth to a son, Rick, less than a year after the wedding, and added a second son, Doug, in 1963, and finally a daughter, Susan, in 1967. After a decade in Omaha, the Johnstons moved to Kansas City in 1971, where Bob went into insurance with Allstate, and Elaine continued to work off and on as a nurse. Following in her older sister Elaine's footsteps, Marty graduated from Gregory High in 1962 and also went into nursing after spending a summer in California. After completing her RN and working for a year in Omaha as a nurse, Marty married Bill Allam in 1966 and spent an adventurous few years in Japan before settling in Southern California. In 1969, she gave birth to a daughter, Sean, and in 1975, a son, Todd, who both grew up on their small acreage in Highland, California, that had room for the horses Marty had always wanted as a girl. Larry was the last of the Ritter kids to graduate from Gregory High School in 1965, and probably the smartest of his many career moves. As the Vietnam War expanded in the mid-1960s, Larry joined ROTC but majored in pharmacy at South Dakota State University, keeping him in the Army but far from combat in Southeast Asia. He married Linda Bray in December of 1969, and after graduating from SDSU in 1970, was stationed as an Army captain, first in Kentucky, then at Fort Benning, Georgia, where son Jonathan, that's me, was born in February of 1972. The following year, they moved to Kansas, where second son Matthew was born in 1974, and Larry began attending veterinary school at Kansas State University after getting out of the Army. They relocated to Mitchell, South Dakota in 1979, just 2 hours' drive from Gregory. Throughout the 1960s and 70s, as their family grew to include their children's spouses and 11 grandchildren spread out all over the United States, Grandma and Grandpa remained on the farm, where the cycle of seasons, of planting and harvesting, raising chicks, feeding lambs, and herding cows never ceased. Those quiet times, though, were interrupted at several points throughout the year, especially at Christmas, when the entire family would descend on the farmhouse, with its single bathroom policed by a stopwatch bearing Uncle Bob. Many of the fond memories my generation holds of the farm come from those holidays, when we camped out on the living room floor and opened mountains of presents on Christmas morning. Other traditions remembered by our parents from their childhood lived on, including feeding the lambs, sledding down the hill, driving the Jeep, and yes, even dress up. Another popular gathering time at the farm beginning in the 1970s came during the opening weekend of pheasant hunting season in mid-October. First introduced to South Dakota in 1898, The Chinese ringneck pheasant found a natural habitat in the shelter belts and cornrows of the Dakota prairie, and pheasant hunting has recently become an important part of the local economy. For most of our family, though, shooting birds has been primarily just an excuse to get everyone back together again. Alfred and Janetta Ritter celebrated their 40th wedding anniversary in 1977, and after nearly four decades of farming, they finally retired to town a few years later in 1981. Alfred and his brothers reunited for the last time in the early 1980s at the farm, more than 60 years after they had last all lived there together. Emmett died shortly thereafter, and Lester passed on in 1999. Eldest grandson Dick Dummer set up a dairy operation at the farm for a few years after Grandma and Grandpa's retirement, but the 1980s were hard years for family farmers, and he eventually moved on. For the first time since 1905, the farm was uninhabited. The Ritter siblings, who now owned the land, rented it out to area farmers for cultivation or pasture, and the house was rented to a local family in the 1990s, though the residents did little to care for the property and its rich history. The farm soon began sinking into disrepair, threatening to fall into a ruin of collapsed barns and rusty windmills, like so many others across the Great Plains today. After years of talking about its fate, in the fall of 2001, Larry Ritter made a decision to begin renovating the home quarter, hoping to return some of its former glory. Create a gathering place for future generations of the Ritter family.
What we plan on doing with the house, first thing we've done is put the foundation under it. By the end of the summer, we're going to have it completely repainted. We're going to have a new roof on it. We're going to have all new windows in it. And then Susan, my niece, will be living in the house, and she's going to be doing all the inside work, pulling down all the old wallpaper. We're going to redo the bathroom, put new electrical and plumbing into it. Have all new floor coverings in it.
With the help of his siblings, other family members, and especially Susan Johnston and her daughter Caitlin, who renovated the house interior while living there in the summer and fall of 2002, the farm has indeed come back to life. Celebrate the 100th anniversary of the farm, we also celebrate the family that has called it home. Grandpa Alfred turned 98 on March 4, 2004, and he and Grandma marked their 67th wedding anniversary 3 months later. At last count, their family includes 4 children, 11 grandchildren, 15 great-grandchildren, with 3 more on the way, and with the birth of Braden Joseph Hudson on November 3, 2002, their first great-great-grandchild. The story of our farm and our family is a story of hard work and perseverance, of love and faith, of hardship, and ultimately renewal. In many ways, it's also the story of America in the 20th century, the final days of the frontier era, the dust storms of the Great Depression, of growth and prosperity at mid-century, and the slow decline and economic uncertainty of family farming on the Great Plains in recent decades. In the best spirit of American storytelling, though, this one has a happy ending, one that we hope will endure for generations to come. Thank you.